So I've been studying the food system for well over a decade now. I've published dozens of peer-reviewed journal articles. I actually edit a journal myself. I have been featured in periodicals like the New York Times, Business Week, CNN. And I'm here today to ask you one of the most important questions, I think, in our entire field today. Before I ask, I just want you to know that this is a political question, and so just try to keep an open mind about it. Can I get a show of hands? How many of you agree with the statement that a hot dog is a sandwich? Okay, we got a couple. Let me ask it again, and those of you that agree, I want to hear you agree. Is a hot dog a sandwich? Yeah. All right, we got a few. What would it take for me to change the rest of y'all's mind? This talk is going to discuss how I might change your mind. Here are three steps about how to think through the U.S. food system and how to maybe update the way you process how you eat. The first step is to be aware of your cognitive biases. Now, everybody has a cognitive bias. We've all heard about a cognitive bias. And I think that what probably matters the most for the hot dog sandwich debate is social pressure. So this is actually a paper we published recently about social pressure on farm. So we looked at conservation tillage in Michigan to look at how farmers make decisions. We assume that they make decisions based on profit motives. But actually what we find is that quite often, farmers choose what to raise and how to till based on what their friends do. So this is the mathy way to do it, but this is the meme way to do it. Basically, everybody thinks they're different, but they all have some type of a pressure on themselves. It's just like as soon as people started cheering about hot dog sandwiches, you probably looked around to see what your friends thought too. All right, step two, use the scientific method. Now, everybody talks about trusting science and believe science, and that's very important, but I think that we have this assumption that science is a dogma. You know, science is actually a method. And so, you know, y'all have probably seen this in your middle school, high school science class. We have an observation, we look through a hypothesis, and then we find a way to empirically test that hypothesis. So the way that you might settle the hot dog sandwich debate is by actually exploring what other people in the United States think. Well, actually, this study, believe it or not, has been done. And 36% of Americans believe that a hot dog is, in fact, a sandwich. So for those of you that held out and said that it wasn't, well, congratulations. The science says you're right. So this is step two. Now, step three, I think, is probably the most important step, updating your prior belief. Now, this can be a hard step, right? Like, I have some preconceived notion about whether or not a hot dog is a sandwich. And if somebody says otherwise, I immediately try to double down on my original opinion. But you need to think about how to change your own mind. Actually, it's so embedded in American culture or in just social culture more generally to change your mind or be willing to that Oscar Mayer ran a brilliant marketing campaign where they set up a toll-free hotline and you could literally call in to argue about whether or not you thought a hot dog was a sandwich. One of the most successful hot dog campaigns of the last 20 years. This makes the Wienermobile look, mediocre. So step three is updating your prior beliefs. So we've gone through some data now. Let's think about it. How many of you now agree that a hot dog is a sandwich? A little bit. Not maybe a few less. Let me go with one that I think you probably all have a pretty standard opinion on. True or false, COVID-19 proves that the U.S. food system is broken. Let me get a show of hands. How many of you agree with the statement that COVID-19 proves that the U.S. food system is broken? Yeah, basically all of you. So I'm here today to argue that it's not, or at least that COVID-19 doesn't prove so. So let's walk through our three-step process. Actually, before we step into that three-step process, I don't want to make you feel like you are alone in feeling that the food system is broken. If you read the New York Times, they're going to tell you the food system is broken. If you read BBC, they're going to tell you the food system is broken. Switch over to The Hill, well, the food system is broken. Maybe Fortune. Nope, Fortune's going to tell you the food system is broken, and also CNN will also tell you that the food system is broken. So you're not alone in feeling like the food system is broken. But I think that it's important for us to at least explore what that broken food system looked like throughout COVID-19. Broken in quotations. So step one is to be aware of your cognitive biases. Now, the one that I think probably matters the most for most Americans is this idea called rosy retrospection. So rosy retrospection is this notion that we have this assumption that once upon a time, things used to be great. We don't know when that time was, but we just know that it used to be better than it is now. That's just the standard belief system that we all cognitively process our world through. This is especially true in agriculture, where less than 2% of Americans are actually directly involved in agriculture. So where do you get your ag information? Well, probably television and documentaries. You probably watched Little House on the Prairie and thought, wow, it would be cool to live in Kansas. I'm from there. Not there now. You could maybe have watched Gone with the Wind. Gone with the Wind is a wonderful movie, but I can promise you that living in the 19th century in America was not nearly as nice as it is now. Sure looks that way on TV, though. Or maybe you're super sciencey, so you watch a documentary like Food Inc., and the science, anti-science take is that, the system used to be better before we actually scientifically worked through agricultural production. But let's be real. Most of you probably didn't even watch these. You probably went through social media to have some snippet of an idea of what the food system looked like once upon a time. So this combination of social pressure through social media and rosy retrospection creates this, I think, modified version of how the food system really works. So there's the cognitive bias. Let's take a look at what the actual food system looked like once upon a time. So in 1975, the average grocery store had less than 8,000 options. The average grocery store before COVID-19 had 45,000 options. We've seen an explosion in novel products in the U.S. food system. It's incredible. I'm a millennial. I got to see the whole thing take off. Don't believe me? Let's walk through some of my favorites that you wouldn't have found in 1975. Do you like cookies? What about cereal? Well, then you will love Cookie Crisp cereal. Yes, yes. Okay, how about Doritos? Everybody likes a Dorito. But if you like a Dorito, you'll almost definitely love tacos. Then you will adore Doritos Locos Tacos. Okay, we'll do some more. How about pizza? Everybody in America adores pizza. We've already established that there's some hot dog folks in the room. I love Pizza Hut Hot Dog Bites pizza. It is delicious. All right, so the last one, and this is honestly a true thing that I love. It's a 2 in the morning kind of treat, and you got to really know where to find it. Do you like Oreos? Yeah, we got some Oreo lovers. How about Swedish Fish? Yeah? Okay. Swedish Fish Oreos are for you. They're delicious. Don't hate on my Swedish Fish Oreos. All right? So what happened during COVID-19 is that we actually saw the food companies and the grocery stores decide to pivot away from these kind of more niche products into the core products that they needed to focus on. Now, again, in 1975, there were 8,000 options, and I can promise you that we didn't see a decline in the number of options at your grocery store to anywhere near what that grocery store option was before. So, A, you think you know what the food system looked like, but the reality is that the grocery stores simplified their menus, but not anywhere near where those simplified menus looked in 1975. All right, so let's go to step two. So, step two is a scientific method. We're all familiar. We observed empty grocery store shelves. We all did. Every single one of us went to the grocery store and either couldn't buy our toilet paper or couldn't buy our eggs, whatever it was. Well, let's talk about what that looks like in data. Let's actually set some numbers to this. So this is a figure of personal consumption expenditures in the United States at grocery stores and restaurants. Now, the blue line is the grocery store. And notice how that line from the first quarter of 2019 up until 2021, fourth quarter, has seen this nice, clean increase. Now look at the red line. That red line has plummeted. Remember what that first quarter of 2020 looked like? It was insane. Nobody went to a restaurant. And believe it or not, restaurant sales have not picked up to the same level, at least relative to grocery stores, as they were before. So we're still feeling this pivot in the U.S. food system. Now, this is a little bit maybe complicated. This is basically what was happening. This is the less mathy way. We just didn't go to restaurants anymore. It's also probably helpful to think about this in terms of an actual food product. So let's talk about some research we've been doing. So we published a paper recently in Food Policy, the journal, where we looked at eggs in the United States. Now, everybody's familiar with an egg, but you probably don't know that there are basically two different egg systems. You have the breaking stock liquid eggs, which go to restaurants, and then you have the shell eggs, which are what you all see at the grocery store. So when COVID-19 hit, you all saw the egg prices too. The shell egg prices spiked like crazy. Guess what happened to those breaking stock restaurant eggs? They were cheaper than bottled water. If you were willing to, you could have just gone and bought the restaurant eggs for much cheaper. You didn't, but that was an option. And it was fundamentally because of these two parallel supply chains that operate within the egg system. So back to my meme. This is the cool meme about what happened during COVID. Well, this is basically what happened to the shell egg guys. Okay, so this is what the real story of the COVID-19 food crisis actually looks like. So the scientific method leads us to understand, at least, that COVID-19 created this massive, unexpected shift away from food at restaurants to food at grocery stores. Nobody saw it coming. And that led to these wild pivots and gaps in prices. So let's go to step three. Update your prior beliefs. So step three, again, is the most important step. What is your prior about food? Odds are, it looks like this. This is me eating my favorite sandwich. This is, it's called the Boss Log. It's at Meat Barbecue in Lansing, Michigan. If you've never had it, it's about as tall as I am. Everybody's got that sandwich though, right? You've got that sandwich that it's so comforting on your taste buds that it feels like your taste buds like got a back massage, you know? Or the flavor is just so powerful that it feels like Dolly Parton punched you in the mouth. That is this sandwich for me. And I would assume that everybody in this room probably also has a similar sandwich. Okay? So you understand the sandwich side. And as we've talked about, you probably think you understand the farmer side. Well, this is my favorite bad farmer show. This is a featuring Paris Hilton and Nicole Richie. They go to work on a Arkansas farm where they learn all kinds of things. I am not exaggerating. There is a part of the show where Paris Hilton has to ask what a Walmart is. It's a terrible show. But you at least know that these shows exist. Now, there's a middle part here, though. That middle part is processing and distribution. And odds are you know nothing about processing and distribution. There's no TV shows. So what happens in there? Well, guess what? 86% of the food system happens in there. 86% of every dollar you spend on food does not go to a farmer. It goes to the processing and distribution sector of the food system. This is really important, and yet you probably don't even have a prior on it. That's really important when we start especially thinking about what COVID-19 looked like in the U.S. food system. So this is a picture of my family ranch back in Laverne, Oklahoma. This is a bunch of guys drinking a beer, wearing their cool cowboy hats. They just worked with the cows. You can see the cows in the background. Anybody have any idea how long it takes to bring a cow to a cheeseburger? any idea? Well, I would assume most of you think that it's probably less than a year. Believe it or not, it takes generally over 2 years to be able to process an animal all the way through the system. And so when COVID-19 hit, we were already thinking about that cheeseburger you were going to eat in March 2020 in March 2018. So that massive pivot that we already have walked through created all kinds of these ripple effects. Think about all of the awesome things that we did not get to do. We didn't get to have opening day. We didn't get to have March Madness. We didn't get to have St. Patrick's Day. Now, apparently, Michigan State people think they can do St. Patrick's Day well. I don't know. It's yet to be seen for me. And it definitely wasn't seen in 2020 because it didn't even happen. It was like it didn't even exist. Think about all the green beer that had to be poured down the drain. Think about all of the chicken wings that didn't get eaten. All of these things were already processed and thought through in the entire food system and then just didn't get eaten. So that created this weird lag. Maybe like this. So you had popular eating and drinking events, and then COVID-19 slapped those things away. We lost them all. That is what happened during the food system that you probably don't think about the processing side of that long pivot away from the popular food and drinking events. So the last piece here is to remember and understand that biology is important for agricultural and food production. Regardless of the food system that we're talking about, you can't turn on a spigot for a cheeseburger. There is a biological process that is required within that processing and distribution and supply side that cannot just go away. And that's what we saw throughout COVID-19. Now, I'm not trying to tell you that the U.S. food system is perfect. I'm not trying to tell you that the U.S. food system won't have any or experience any type of massive issues in the next few years. I mean, when we think about climate change, when we think about aging farming populations, when we think about the opioid crisis, when we think about labor shortages, geopolitics, there are so many different things that we have to think about in the U.S. food system. But what I do want you to remember as we work through all of those things is that you need to keep in the back of your mind this massively important question. What would it take to change my mind about the U.S. food system? So let me ask one more time. COVID-19 proves that the U.S. food system is broken. True or false? Thank you very much.